Right. We're going to start off with some prayer tonight. Brother Shane Malloy couldn't make it and said something up, but we need to pray for Sister Darlene. She obviously is battling cancer, but she also has mentioned, I talked to her today for a little bit, and she's got COVID. Of course, she's a little overwhelmed with that, rightly so, with all the stuff going in and you know, how doctors are. They're going to tell you worst case scenario, and then she sees another specialist and this specialist, and of course they all have their opinions and reports. There's an old song that says, whose report will you believe? I will believe the report of the Lord, and it's scripture, so we're going to believe that tonight. Brother Van Allen is out traveling, but he texted me earlier asking for prayer for Dana Stanford. This is the granddaughter of Brother Denver Stanford. And I believe Brother Denver Stanford is his pastor, his first pastor back in Boston, where they're from, and his mentor. So this would be the granddaughter. She is on life support and has a 50-50% chance in ICU. I'm thankful that I've been to ICU at least more than one occasion, not personally for my situation, but the power of God has healed people. I've seen the lame walk. I've seen cancer healed. And I've seen things happen, so we'll believe for that tonight, that God will touch Sister Darlene, Dana Stanford. Any other prayer requests tonight?
Still for my sister's dad.
Your sister's dad. What's his name again?
Eddie.
Eddie, okay. Remember Eddie. All right. We'll pray, and then we'll get right into singing in our lesson. Jesus, we praise you tonight. We thank you for your goodness. We ask you, God, that you touch Sister Dana Stanford, Lord, that you would step into that ICU room. God, that your presence would fill that place of peace, healing. In the name of Jesus, we speak life, God. We rebuke death. We pray your will be done in the name of Jesus. We ask, God, that you touch Eddie, God, that you'd work a miraculous touch in his life, intervene. God, touch Sister Darlene tonight, God. Give her strength, God, in her body, in her mind, in her spirit. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. All right, we're going to worship for a little bit tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
God. Amen. There is nobody like Jesus. Praise God. Well, we're going to get started. We have a new series or lesson that I've been wanting to teach, and glad that we can. And of course, we're calling it Our Foundation, and part one. It may be a couple of parts here. Of course, we got a little bit of a blueprint, you know, foundation. I'm not a construction worker. I've done any of that. But, you know, we'll go with that theme. And so I want to talk, first of all, let's have the scripture up. I did the New King James Version, 2 Peter 1, 1 through 4. And very simply, Simon Peter, a bondservant, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. So tonight, what's our purpose? Obviously, we want to understand Jesus. We understand Christ. He is the foundation of our salvation. He's our Savior. He's our Lord. He's our King. And in him only are we complete. And beside him, there is no other Savior. And I know we know that, but it's good to just visit this again, the foundation, because what, you know, is the foundation, if it's set just right, it's going to hold up everything else. You know, if we don't have a clear understanding and get even more clear understanding of who Jesus is, then everything we built on it can just be swayed away. The simplest analogy I can use tonight is been married 21 years, going to be 22 years this June, and my wife thought she knew me, and then a year later, once we get married, and then she's like, oh, this is the real Jeremiah. 5 years down the road, she's like, oh my goodness, there's more to him. And you're still kind of learning. You know each other, but you know how it is, those that are married. And so Jesus is our author and finisher of our faith. He's everything we need. We don't need anything else, but we need Jesus himself. If we have him, we have everything we need. The scripture I want to focus tonight as well is Deuteronomy 6, 4 and 9. So we can explain it a bit. And it simply says this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. In other words, this is a whole day thing, a 24/7 lifestyle. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. So very strong words there that the Lord is saying. It's important, everything you do all day long. So I want to focus on the Shema. Now, I'm going to speak some Hebrew. It's not the Holy Ghost. I'm not speaking in tongues like that tonight. I'm probably not going to say it right. I looked online trying to say these things right, but it's not my language, of course. If Sister Missy Salcido was here, who went to school and had some classes on that, she would be able to tell us. Like she calls my son Solomon. If you ever hear us call him Shlomo, that's Hebrew, Shlomo for Solomon. And so some of the youth will say that. Well, she's the one that taught us that, and the youth stuck with it. But the Shema prayer, it is the foundation of the Jewish religion, and it continues to be monotheism. Monotheism, in other words, not only that there is one God, but that God is one. And this scripture is called the Shema. It is actually a prayer, and it is the most important prayers of all the Jewish prayers. I want you to note that. This is the most important prayers of all the prayers that the Jews pray. And here's some Hebrew. We'll try to say it. It may sound a little familiar if you've heard singing or something of that nature. And this is the prayer, the first part of it. Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. So hopefully I said that right. But these are the first words of the Jewish prayer, again known as Shema Israel. And it's a declaration of faith and a pledge of allegiance to God, saying, we are declaring that you are one God. We're declaring you are the God of Israel, and we're declaring that we are with you. And so that is the most important prayer that the Jews pray. The Shema, again, is the first prayer taught to Jewish children. That's how important it is. The first prayer they're teaching is this prayer, which is the Word of God. And so they teach it, and it is the last word spoken before death. So, you know, actions speak louder than words sometimes, and you can see these actions here. It is a prayer of praise to God, and it is a prayer of earnest pleading. And in the Torah, Moses gives the Shema to his people, the nation of Israel, in his last words to them. He even did it himself before he died. Deuteronomy 6:4-9, God dictates that the Shema is to be contained in the mezuzah. Hopefully I said that right. But basically it's paper, parchment, inscribed in the script with scriptures that Jews literally affix to their doorsteps. They put it on their doorsteps. God also dictates that the Shema should be worn close to the head and to the heart. And again, the Shema of Israel is recited aloud as follows. Shema Israel Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad, which in English means, hear, O Israel, the Eternal is our God, the Eternal is one. This word, I've tried to get it, but it's hard. The Bahavata, I think. Almost sounds a little Spanish there, you know, saying like someone's bata, but anyways. But we'll continue. So this verse, it's this word is the next verse following the Shema, and it's called Behavata. And the English translation is this: blessed be God's name and glorious kingdom forever and ever. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And these words which I, God, teach you this day shall be upon your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. Speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. And you shall bind them as a sign upon your hand, and they shall be for a reminder before your eyes. God is telling them, I need you to know who I am. I need you to remind yourself and your children all the time, with all your heart, all your might, all your soul. Very serious words there. And you shall write them on the doorpost of your house and upon your gates. Going back to the Shema prayer. The Shema prayer, again, written on a scroll. It's placed inside the mezuzah. Hopefully I said that right again. And in the tefillin that is bound to the arm and to the head. If you've ever seen Jews, we've seen them by the church in Fort Lowell. They have a Jewish community center. Sometimes you see that there, and you're wondering what it's about. Well, this is what it's about. The Shema says to bind the words upon your hands and before your eyes in Deuteronomy. And so you'll see that happening with Jews. The Tefillin are also known as, and I don't know how to pronounce this, phylacterius. And basically it's tied to the arm and another to the head again. God always and only, here's another point I want to bring tonight, revealed himself as one to his people. You will see that. We're talking New Testament. Next couple of weeks we'll get into the New Testament and connect these all together and how it works. But God has always revealed himself as one. When Moses went to go before Pharaoh, God's like, I need you to go to Pharaoh. I need you to get my people out. God is talking, you know, to Moses. Moses is talking to God. And we know that story, those that are familiar with it. He's in the wilderness. A fiery bush, he appears to him, and there's a relationship that goes. But he's telling him, you're going to go to Pharaoh. I need you to go to Pharaoh. And then Moses asks that question in the Bible, who shall I say sent me? I need a name. I need a name. And the Lord told him to say to his people simply this, and of course to the Israelites too, I am hath sent me unto you. I am. And we will find it here, Exodus 3:13-14, Moses and God speaking. Then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. I am has sent me to you. The reason this is important, and we'll discuss this in the next few weeks, but is when Jesus went, and the Pharisees and Sadducees, when he healed people, when he was doing all these things, he was saying, I am he. He used the words, I am. And the Jews immediately were saying, this is blasphemy. This man's claiming to be God. Only God can heal the sick. Only God can do these miracles, they would say. Or they would say, only God can forgive sins, because the sick of the palsy, he looked at, and I'm kind of skipping in the next few weeks, but he looked at the sick of the palsy, palsy meaning seizures. And he's having seizures, and they said, heal him. The friend said, could you heal him, Master? And the first thing he does, because you got to remember, God came, robed himself in flesh for what? To die for our sins. He says, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. And they're blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins. And so you can see the correlation there just a little bit. So it's important. So when Jesus says, I am, in the Gospels, they knew exactly what he was saying. Abraham, the prophets, and even the apostles, Abraham, the father of our faith, believed in one God. Moses believed in one God. All the prophets taught, believed in only one God. The apostles believed only in one God. And in the Old Testament, you can read all about it with the Israelites. When they would fall away, in other words, when they would leave the truth, when they would stop being faithful to the Lord, they begin to bow down to other gods, idols, and serve many gods, just like the nations that surrounded them. In other words, they wanted to fit in, they wanted to blend in, they want to be like the other nation. You know, God calls us to be different. However that is, we're different, not just in the way we look, but our lifestyle, our spirit. You know, they may wonder at work why, you know, and yes, we do lose our temper. Yes, we do make mistakes. We're human. We're not robots. We're not God. But other people are panicking. Other people are angry, and yet you don't respond that way. And sometimes my wife, she's very shocked because I'm a very mild, meek person. Yeah, right. And, you know, there's been times I'm like, you're right, I'm sorry. And she goes, what, who are you? And I'm not kidding. She's next door, so I can talk a little bit about. And I'm like, I prayed today. I prayed through today, seriously. And so we strive for that. But the Israelites, God's physical people, would go astray, serve idols, serve other gods. And God is a jealous God, the Bible says. And so God would then allow tragedies to take place in their lives. God does not allow trials and situations to come into our lives because he hates us. I mean, if he hates us, he would just let us die and that's it. But he does it so we can humble ourselves. Either we humble ourselves willingly, as the scripture says, he resists the proud, the prideful. I don't need you, God. And you may not say it, but sometimes we do when we don't depend on him, when we don't live by the word of God and only by bread, as he says. And so, daily. And so, if we don't do that, God loves us so much that he will allow circumstances in our lives to just kind of like an avalanche, or sometimes like a snowball coming down, and it just gets bigger and bigger to the point where we finally say, help, Jesus, I'm sorry, please. Because he loves us that much. Not to kill us, not to destroy us, because he loves us. So he did that to his people, Israel, and this nation. And so that they could repent, come back to the foundation of their faith in the one true God, the I Am. In the New Testament, we'll talk a little bit about it tonight. You see the same thing with the apostles. People begin to twist the scriptures according to their ideologies. Well, I think this and I think that. Well, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what I think. It doesn't matter what you think. But we got to look into the scriptures, and not just one scripture and make a doctrine out of it. We're going to see what the apostles did. Actions mean louder words. We're going to see, did they obey Jesus? And are they doing what the Old Testament says? Because you can't base doctrine off one scripture. You must have multiple scriptures there for a pattern. And, you know, and that's what the apostles, and the apostles didn't even have the scriptures. They only had the Old Testament to go on at that time. And so, but yet people would come in and have their own ideologies, their own thoughts. It would bring destruction due to their imaginations. That's why you have the epistles. The book of Acts is the New Testament church. We're a part of that. But after that, you got the book of Romans, because Romans, they've already been saved. Corinthians, Galatians, he's talking to the church. He's not talking to new people. So he's correcting them. He's helping them, telling them, don't obey the vain philosophies of men or traditions of men. And we must rightly divide the word of truth. That means that all doctrine must stand the test of being in harmony with all 66 books of the Bible. Otherwise, it's not sound doctrine. It's not sound doctrine. And we got to make sure that we're interpreting it right. And it can't be us. We need to ask the Lord Jesus for it and the Spirit of God. The Spirit will always say the same thing as the Word of God. If you're saying you hear from the Lord, I say I heard from the Lord to go do something. I know this may be a very simplistic, analogy. You know, if someone says that the Lord told me to leave my wife just because he wants me to suffer, which I would. Well, that doesn't really sound right, does it? You know, it doesn't sound right. We're going to go to the Bible and see, okay, what did just cause it? You know, why would God do that? You know, well, he wants you to leave your wife because God wants her to marry someone else. No, that's not how it works. Now, I understand we're not trying to get into divorce and all that stuff and the exclusions, but you understand what I'm saying. You have to look at the Word of God. You have to see what it means. 1 Timothy 4:16, take heed to yourself and to doctrine, talking to Timothy, a young pastor. Continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Those who hear you. So you've got to take heed to that. In the New Testament, sound doctrine is essential for salvation. 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. If we want doctrine, doctrine means the teachings, the doctrine, the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then we got to make sure it's from the scripture and not our own ideals. For reproof, believe it or not, the Holy Ghost did come to save, and that Spirit of Christ in us will resurrect us at that glorious day, that rapture time, when the trumpet shall sound. If we're here, as the Bible says, if we which remain shall be caught up together in the earth, for the dead in Christ shall rise first. Well, I don't have the power, but the Holy Ghost has the power. That's why you need the Holy Ghost. You need to be resurrected. You got to be changed. That's that. Where are we basing that off? We're basing that off the scriptures. That's where the scriptures are telling us. Not my ideology, not your thoughts, but what the scripture says. So, but the scripture also says that the Holy Ghost came to save and to reprove, which means rebuke, reproof, correct. And God loves us and he wants to correct us. And so we look at it, the scriptures, for that. And instruction in righteousness. Righteousness is truth. Righteousness is purity. You know, if someone's dealing with impurities of heart, whether it be lust, whether it be just, you know, when we use the word perverted, it is not just talking about sexual sins, but perverted. What does it mean? You pervert the doctrine. You pervert the gospel. It means that you're not teaching what the apostles, what Jesus, what the prophets all together in unison taught. That means you have perverted the way. In other words, you have a sidewalk. And it has a clear path to, say, across to a school from your house or the street. But then all of a crosswalk, and then all of a sudden you change it and you move the lines. Well, you just perverted it. You just led it astray, and now it's not a safe place, so to speak. So all scripture is given by God for doctrine. All scripture is given by God for instruction in righteousness. You can't add or take away from the scriptures and still maintain sound doctrine. I don't know who I was talking to. But I told him that there is a Bible that President Jefferson wrote. And I said he did his own thing. He wrote his own. Was it you, Kendall? I think it was. It was him. He's smiling at me. And he, you know, I'm a jokester. So he was like, I don't believe you. I don't believe you. And I was like, yes, he did. He wrote his own Bible and he took out what he didn't like. In other words, I don't really think Jesus did those miracles. So he took it out. You read up on it. And he goes, I don't believe it. Have you Googled that? You need to Google that, because I'm not lying. I'm behind this thing, this pulpit right here. So give me some credit. And so he did that. And, you know, to be honest, in my carnal, wicked ways, I would like to do that. I'd be like, that sounds silly. Not take that out. I don't like that. I don't want that, you know. This is, you know, I'm not going to do it. But I can't. I mean, we can. But unfortunately, Thomas Jefferson, whether we like them as a president or not, I know it's hundreds of years ago, for all you history buffs, if he kept it that way, he's not in heaven today. You can't take and add from it. Now, we won't physically take and add from it, but I'll tell you what we do mentally and spiritually, and I'm guilty of it too. We're like, I don't like what that says. Well, it repeats itself 2-3 times at least in the scripture. Well, I don't think I want to. Nah, I'm not going to do it. Well, you probably should, because that attitude is I'm taken away, taken away. So in the New Testament, actually, that's a typo. I guess I left that in there. Kept leaving it in there. Well, oh well. All right. Coffee ran out when I was putting this together. But in the Old Testament and the New Testament scriptures as well, but we're focusing on the Old Testament tonight, God reaffirms that he is one throughout hundreds of Old and New Testament scriptures. So we don't have just 2 or 3 that we're basing it off. We're basing it off hundreds of scriptures. And we can go through a whole list, have an extensive list, but I wanted to give you some key ones based on the Old Testament. So here's just a few for your studies, for your consideration. Isaiah, the prophet, chapter 1, 24, he talks about the Mighty One. Isaiah 5:19, the Holy One. Isaiah 43:10-12, there was no God formed before him or after him. He alone is God. That's what the scripture says. Before, after him, there isn't. I'm the only one. Isaiah 44:6-8, he is the first and the last. No God beside him. Isaiah 45:5, no God besides the Lord. Hosea, the book of Hosea 13:4, no Savior besides the Lord. Malachi, great name, 2:10, one Father, one God that created us all. And so we don't declare this in prideful sense. We declare this scripture in the sense of we want to know God more and we want to share more. Many have a beginning with the Lord and they experience the Holy Ghost, they experience repentance. But man, if I could get everybody's attention and let them know, man, that's fantastic. But there's much more to God than you realize. If we could do that, I mean, absolutely. I guess I'd be a televangelist and then I'd probably go the different way. But anyways, mass televangelist. But God is one. It's throughout the Old Testament, in the New Testament. The next week or two, we'll talk about it some more. And I'll have some more scriptures and whatnot there. So tonight, I kept it very simple, very concise. Any questions? If it's about end time, Brother Malloy is not here, so.
We're actually correct by the Bible. That Bible, it's actually called the Life of Morals of Jesus Christ, but they call it the Jefferson Bible.
The Jefferson Bible.
It's only 86 pages.
There you go. See? There you, wow. He really took it out, man. Yeah, you believe me now, Kendall?
Yeah, he's like, I don't know about that.
I think he really liked Thomas Jefferson.
it only goes 200 years old, but it only was found in 1904.
Yeah, there you go. So thank you so much for that validation that I'm not lying and joking tonight. Amen. But any questions, let me know. If not, you can text me.
I didn't think you were lying. I thought it was a joke.
Oh, you thought it was a joke. That's why I thought it was a joke. Yeah. Let me say this. Why do we visit this again? Because it's our foundation. And we got to know who God is. That foundation right here, I'm not a construction worker, but the simple things I know is if this has some cracks, actually at the Stuvey homes, they're not here tonight, but you know, we went to their house, they were letting me know how bad, I was like, what a beautiful home. And then they're like, yeah, the foundation's horrible. And there's a lawsuit I read in the news here in Marana, but and God be with them on that, seriously. But it's sinking, you know, in the backyard where Missy Jacob, we were standing there, and you could tell and everything. And I wouldn't have noticed anything, but, you know, obviously the homeowners, Don and Todd Stuber, like, yeah, it's not working. And Chad was there, and, of course, he was telling us his house is worse. And all that foundation is not set right. You don't really see it if you put bricks on it. You put, you know, on that cement, concrete, whatever, and that hard dirt. But if it's not settled right, when the pressures of that building and structure come, things start to shift and crack. Well, spiritually speaking, if our foundation isn't right with knowing who God is, our structures, the trials of life, things are going to come. But man, once you know who God is, it is so sweet. It's like you can, you know, in our worst day, on our worst day of messing up even and failing God, it's like we still know who he is. We know who we can run to. That's why the scripture says in the Old Testament as well, that I believe the book of Proverbs, The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it. Amen. I'm so thankful. I don't have to be like, well, which tower am I running into, you know, today? No, I know who God is, and I know the God of the Old Testament was robed in flesh, and his name is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Why don't we thank God for that right now? Lift our hands and love the Lord. Thank you, God, for this revelation. We don't take pride. We don't think we're better than anybody, God, but we're so humbled and so grateful that you would give us this revelation of the mighty God in Christ Jesus. We know that we're still learning, God, and we're thankful, God, that we can run to you. You're a strong tower, a righteous name. The name of the Lord Jesus is a strong tower, and we run into it, God, and we are saved by that name, as your scripture says. In Jesus' name, we bless you, Lord. Amen. We praise you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Praise God. I think those children are done. Yeah, those three classes. They're having more fun than us. Yes, yes, yes. Next week, unfortunately, not unfortunately, there is a wedding rehearsal because young Caleb Connor decided he wants to get married. So I don't know why he would do that. I know she's a beautiful young lady, but we thought he was blind. But the rehearsal's there, and the barn castles are out, the sand castles are out, we're out, everybody out. So we apologize for that, but we'll continue the following week. So, all right. I could kill him. I'm kidding.